seated. Sister Vesta is going to sing for us tonight.
I told Jamie that I would try to practice a song and try to sing one night, but I didn't know it was going to be this quick. But, you know, as a little girl, we sang all the time, and I've sung in groups before. But no matter how often you sing, when you get up here, it's a different story. But just pray that I would do what God would want me to do, not what I'm doing. It's for His glory. But pray for Natalie. She's hurt her ankle, and they think it's a fracture, so they're going to send her to an orthopedic doctor, and hopefully they'll put her in a boot, because I worry about her walking on those crutches. And then I got a call when Norma told me that Kim said my mama fell, so I called. She's doing okay, but just pray for her that she'll be all right.
When this life is gone, we will not fear the bad news of a loved one passed on. Where blind eyes will see, and the sick will be.
Us with benefits, the Bible says. And I always like that verse. Amen. Thank God for His goodness. All right, we'll take prayer requests tonight. As I've always said, speak up good and loud so Miss Linda can hear you. She makes down the list. Don't want to leave anybody out. intentionally, so need to speak up good and loud so she can hear you and get that prayer request. And we'll start over here. Brother Roger. All right, pray for Brother Roger's daughter. We sure will, Brother Roger. Sure will. Karen? Yeah. All right. All right. Donna? Okay. Okay. Sure will. I knew somebody can break them with cold hearts.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Brother Bill? Okay. All right. Anybody else on this side? Jada? Yeah, okie dokie, sweetie. We will. Okay. Anybody else? Toots? Okay. All right, she's going to have cataract surgery done on her other eye tomorrow. Okay, all right. Anybody else on this side? Okay, those in the center. Hayden. Okie dokie, pal. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Okay. All right. Sure will. Samantha? Okay. Angela?
I remember Phil in your prayers. He's had a medical test done, so I'd like for everyone to remember him.
Okay. All right. I know Phil goes, not trying to scare you, but Rodney yesterday was at the gym when he had his massive heart attack. So Paul said body exercise profits little. But it can happen anywhere. And it's probably a good thing that it happened there so that people out there would know what to do. Brother Bill? Okay, brother, pray for Brother Bill. He's got some medical procedures coming up. Frankie? Okay. All right. Sure will. Ms. Faye? Okay. All righty. We sure will. Okay. All right. Anybody else in the center? Okay. On this side, Ms. Norma. Okay. All right. Anybody else on this side? Norma, Vesta. Okay. Continue to pray for Sister Emily. Keep her in your prayers. Anybody else? Danny? Okay. All right. Anybody else on this side? Brother Roy?
Remember, Pam, she got the results from her biopsy that he did, and it showed cancer cells, so they're going to do another one, and mom died, but it was too early. Can't act for cancer, but just cancer cells.
All right. Sister Patty's really been through the mill with that stuff, so keep her in your prayers. Allie? Okay. All right. Sister Martha?
I have a prayer.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Amen.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's a blessing. I like to hear them praise report too. Amen. I like to hear people brag on Jesus, what he's doing. Hey, he's still in business, folk. He still answers prayer. Teresa? Okay. Sure will. All right. Anybody else? Anybody have unspoken requests tonight? You'd just like to recognize those by the raising of the hand. Let's have the ushers come forward. Receive our offering tonight. We're going to need a couple of guys to help. We've got some guys missing tonight. Come on, Phil. We'll work you. You don't give, Brother Phil will break your arm. Amen. All right, let's pray and ask the Lord to bless us tonight and bless the offering and use it for his glory and use it for his honor. Brother Bill Noblett, would you pray for us, please? Yes, we thank you, Father. Yes. Granted our Father, yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Bill. Amen. It's good to see y'all tonight. Let me mention also, pray for Brother Smiley Cox. Talked to him today, and they put a brace on his leg and ankle to try to help him. You make it. Come on, Granny. So keep Brother Smiley in your prayers also. And pray that whatever this stuff is to get out of here. Man, I'm telling you. It's awful. I hate this stuff. I said I wouldn't move to Atlanta, but if it's I might have moved there if it helped this stuff around here, but it's probably worse down there than it is up here. But a lot of people getting clogged all this stuff. Mine's been about 3 weeks now, so pray to get out of here. So about time I think it's getting better, and it seems like it gets worse again. But don't forget, Saturday now, and I know they're calling for rain, so we'll just have to do what we can. And so we're still planning on having the Easter get-together and the Easter luncheon. So be sure to bring your, you ladies bring something to eat, amen? Bring something to go with the meat, some desserts, and bring some those plastic eggs filled with candies for the kids so we can hide those for them, give them a little Easter egg hunt. Everybody can come. It's not just for the kids now. Everybody can come. And we want you to come if you can. And it starts at 11 o'clock, goes to about 2 o'clock, so be here if you can. And then Friday night, don't forget, the Easter drama practice starts at 6 o'clock. And we would like for you to be here, if you can, by any means, be here, ready to start practicing at 6. Now, I understand some of you work, and I know that sometimes that's hard to do, but if you can't get here at 6, get here just as soon as you can so we can start. And we're going to have something for you to eat before we practice, or you may have to eat after we get started. We'll just have to see how it works out. But anyway, just have to worry about eating supper. Just come on. And we'll have everything ready and try to have you be, so you won't go away hungry. And we'll get started at 6 o'clock with the practice. Listen, everybody that's in the drama needs to be here Friday night. We only have a couple of three more practices, actually two more dress rehearsals, and one practice, I think, on Sunday. And of course, on Sunday, you know, that's pretty limited to what we can do. So if you could come and be here Friday night, by all means do that. Don't forget tomorrow night. The service at Harry C. White. That's at 7 o'clock. So those of you that can come and go with that, I know you'd enjoy it and plan to go do that if you can. And there's just a lot going on. And so just try to do all you can. And can all you get, amen. So you can use it at a later time, in a later date. All right. I think I mentioned about everything that I was supposed to. Turn your Bibles once again to the book of Ephesians chapter 5. Still talking about the church. Let me just say, it's all right to talk about the church this way. Amen? Some people talk about the church in the wrong way. You ever heard that old saying, if you can't say something good about somebody, don't say nothing? I think we're going to say, if you can't say something good about the church, don't say nothing. Especially if that's where you worship. That's where you tithe. That's where you serve. That's where you sing in the choir. Amen? That's where you sing specials. That's where you play instruments. That's where you sit in the pew and worship. Well, we ought to say something good about our local church and exalt the church and build it up and brag on it, amen. Thank God for what he's done for us. And certainly he's been good to us, and for that we're very, very thankful. But we've been talking about the church, and let me just say how important the church is in this day and time that we live in this world. Let me just say one day the church is getting out of here. I'm talking about the body of believers of Christ, which is the whole church of God. And the Bible speaks of the church of God in the Bible, but that's not talking about a denomination. That's talking about all the believers in the Lord Jesus Christ and we that have been saved. But we have been talking about that for several weeks. Last week we talked about that glorious church concerning the glorious Christ being its founder. I'm glad it's founded upon the Lord Jesus Christ. We talked about it being conceived in eternity. We talked about it being constituted in the earth. And we talked about Jesus was in control of the entire church in its entirety. And that's the way it ought to be. And that's the way it should be. And let me just say, the problem today is people don't want to allow that. You know, they don't respect the pastoral authority. And they don't respect sometimes the authority of Christ in their lives and in the church. We got to realize he's the one that's in charge. And he's the one not only in charge, he's the one that's in control. Amen? So I want to read to you verses 25 down through verse number 27, once again, in the book of Ephesians. We ought to have this memorized about now, but we probably don't. So let's don't take any chances, and let's just read it. Amen. Chapter 5, verse number 25 of the book of Ephesians. The Bible says, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present it himself a glorious church, not having spot nor wrinkle nor any such thing, but that which it should be holy and without blemish." And I'm glad one day it will be presented that way. But until then, we're in this life and we're in this world and we're of this flesh. So there'll be some cleansing that will need to take place, and there'll be some wrinkles that need to be ironed out, and there'll be some blemishes that need to be taken care of. I don't know about you, but this past Monday, I think it was, we had a pretty good hailstorm around Spartanburg County. I don't think we got it as bad down this way, or at least down at our house, like some got it in other places. I mean, some places it looked like a snow and looked like it was on the roads, and the tire marks from the cars and vehicles that were making it was a lot worse than I believe it was down at the house, which is all right with me, amen. Some of you maybe had some blemishes on your houses and on your roof, and maybe some had some on your car. And boy, that's a sad thing when you have a vehicle and it gets banged up with hail. But anyway, the Bible tells us that all these blemishes and all these things in the church one day will be ironed out and taken care of. I hate to wear anything with a wrinkle in it. I would iron my own dress shirts. Linda couldn't iron them good enough. I mean, I couldn't stand one with a wrinkle in it. I mean, so I started taking them to the, I got tired of ironing them, so I started taking them to the dry cleaners. Sometimes you can get a deal if you take five at a time. So that way you can just pull them off the hanger, put them on them, go. And most of the time they don't have a wrinkle, but sometimes even they have a wrinkle. But I don't like to wear anything with a wrinkle in it. I like, pull out a pair of pants or something, been hanging on the hanger and they got a little wrinkle, I can't wear them things. I got to go with the iron. Ryan, are y'all that way? Am I OCD or whatever you call that? I don't know what OCD means. I don't care what it means. I just don't like to wear wrinkled clothes, amen. But that's just the way I am. And this way probably some of you are. And we was talking about this a while ago. I hate to pull a shirt out and have hanger horns on it. I'm not going to wear no shirt with hanger horns. No, sir, ready. I'll just put that thing back in the closet and find something else to wear. I got to iron them things out. And I'm glad that's the way the Lord's going to do the church. You know why? Because we'll not be able to see one wrinkle or one flaw. If I wore a shirt with a wrinkle in it, somebody would notice it. If I wore a shirt with hanger horns in it, somebody would notice it. And that's what it's going to be. I'm glad that when Jesus comes back and the church is taken out of here, all these impurities, all these blemishes, all these wrinkles, all these things are going to be taken out of the church. But until then, we got to keep on keeping on as the Lord would have us to do so. So we see the glorious church, glorious Christ being his founder. Tonight, I would like to bring to you some things concerning not only the founder, but I want you to bring something concerning the glorious cross and it being its foundation. Oh, wow. We said a lot about the foundation that we're built upon in times past, and we've talked about that a lot and really rehashed it several different times. And certainly tonight we know who our foundation is. Our foundation is the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, he's the one that died upon the cross and gave his life for your sins and for my sins. But I'm so thankful tonight that that foundation that we're built upon was based upon the cross of Calvary. And as we look at the portion of Scripture, if you would please, over in the book of Colossians chapter 1, and I'm going to read to you verses 15 down through verse number 20 concerning the foundation that we're built upon and the cross that it represents and it talks about. I'm trying to get there. All these verses tonight, most of them I don't have written down, so we'll be turning to all of them, and I think that's good on a Wednesday night, and because I think it's good that we see it. Don't take the preacher's word for it. Yep. I mean, a lot of people, that's the problem with a lot of churches, a lot of church members today, and the reason people are so shallow, and the reason people are don't really have a good foundation, basically, so to speak, is because they're not grounded in the word, and they take what the preacher says about it. And I know some preachers that said some terrible, weird things. I mean, some things that, boys, just absolutely awful. Like when they say that, you know, it's all right to cuss. I don't know where they got that from. Didn't get that out of the Bible. Like when they say it's all right to take a drink. It's all right to have a drink every now and then. I don't know where they got that from either. You know, the world is geared that way. The world is geared that way. I mean, they think that everybody drinks. They think everybody does the things of the world. I'm glad there's a few, thank God, that's a remnant that don't do those things. Cassian was telling me a moment ago, I went by there a while ago, and Brandon had a birthday, and they wouldn't celebrate his birthday at Texas Roadhouse, and they didn't invite me to go with them again. And I was talking to them about that, and they said once they brought had his birthday cake there, the waitress come out and wanted to know if he could have a beer. And Cassie said, no, he can't have a beer. They said, he can't have one. He said, no, he can't have one. He said, his daddy's a preacher. He said, well, he still can't have one? No, what don't you understand? No means no. Can't have one beer, can't have one drink, amen. That's the way it ought to be. But see, the world thinks that's the way everybody is. But I'm glad our foundation is built. And listen, because we're built upon that foundation, and the foundation of the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ has given us a way that we can resist and stand against those things and not partake of those things. Now, if they've still been in the flesh, if they never visited Calvary, if they've never went to the cross, hey, they'd probably said, yeah, just bring us all one. But after you go to the cross, it makes a difference. Amen. It makes a difference in a person's life. But in Colossians chapter 1, look, if you would, please, verse 15, and let's read down through verse number 20. And also this talks about the preeminence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 15 says, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be by thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, and he is in the beginning of the firstborn from the dead, and in him all things we have should have the preeminence. Verse 19, for it pleased the Father that he should all fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him be to reconcile all things unto himself. For by him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. So we see the Bible tells us here that the glorious cross is its foundation. And of course, it mentions here in verse number 20, it talks about making that peace through the blood of his cross. Thank God for the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the foundation of the cross within itself. Oh, there had been many times that animals' blood had been shed. Sheep, turtle doves, pigeons, all, you know, different animals had been put to death and sacrificed and their blood shed and put upon the altar and so on and so forth. But we're talking about the one sacrifice that took place that was sufficient for the whole church. Now, during the Old Testament time, we know that that's what took place in the Old Testament. We know the high priest had to go in the tabernacle and make intercession and atonement for sins. And the word atonement in the Old Testament is just a putting off of things and until the better thing came, which tells us about in the book of Hebrews when we had that better testament and that better covenant through the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see that the blood of the Lord Jesus took care of it all, took care of all of the problems, all of our sins, took care of anything else that needed to be done. Thank God we no longer have to make sacrifices of ourselves through animals in order to appease for our sins. It took place on Calvary and God took care of it. And that's the foundation that we have. Listen, anytime the devil gives you a problem, and he will, anytime he gets on your back, anytime he begins to cause you to doubt, anytime he begins to cause you to question your salvation, you just take him back to Calvary. Amen. You take him back to where you got saved. And let me just say, it might have been at an altar at the church, it might have been in your car, it might have been at home, it might have been on your job. You might have been out shopping. Yeah, you can get a person can get saved anywhere, and you could have been anywhere. But I'm telling you, the day that you got saved, you was at the cross. And you realized the blood that was shed for your sins, that you could have forgiveness of your sins. And that is our foundation. That's what we can go back to. That's what, and talking about a foundation, that means it's not going to move either. It's not going to change. The foundation is steadfast and sure, the Bible tells us. So what a blessing that is. So we see that foundation of the cross is nothing less than the blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary, as it tells us there in verse number 19 of Colossians chapter 1. Now, we see that the blood that was shed was the blood of a sinless Savior. I'm glad to report to you that our Savior was sinless. In the book of 1 Peter chapter 2, if you'll turn there, please, and I want you to notice, if you would, in chapter 2, verses 21 down through verse number 25, where it talks about the sinless Savior that you and I serve. The Bible says in verse number 21, it says this, "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps." Listen to what it says. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead in sins should live under righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. Verse number 25, "For ye were his sheep, for we are sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and the bishop of our soul." So we see that our foundation is built upon a sinless Savior. Oh, thank God for that. The high priest back in the times when they would go in and present the blood to the mercy seat in the tabernacle as they would enter into the holiest of holies, they had to do that with a clean heart. They had to do that with no sin. First of all, what that priest had to do, he had to first go in and make atonement for his own sins first. Can I say the great high priest that you and I have never had to make an atonement for sins in his life because he was totally and completely sinless? The Bible tells us that. He had no sin. He was sinless within himself. He took upon him the sins of us. But we see as the high priest would go into the holies of holies in the tabernacle, as he would go in once a year to make atonement for the sins of the people, they would tie a rope around his ankle. And as he went in, he had on his priestly garment. And around that priestly garment at the bottom, they had what they call pomegranates. You know what pomegranates are? They were dried out. And when they're dried out, of course, those seeds in those pomegranates would be act as a baby rattler acts. You know, when you give a baby. I don't think they give baby rattlers anymore. I haven't ever seen one in a long time. Maybe they do. I don't had no babies lately, so I don't know. But anyway, those pomegranates would rattle. And as long as they could hear that high priest, as long as he was moving around and they could hear the rattling of those pomegranates on the bottom of his garment, they knew everything was all right. Because see, that high priest, if he went in there and made a sacrifice the wrong way or made a sacrifice without asking forgiveness of his sins, death. He'd die. And the reason nobody else could go in the holies of holies, only the high priest. That's the reason they tied a rope around his ankle. So if they didn't hear him moving around in there, they would take that rope and pull him out, because he had went in and made a sacrifice was still sin in his life. I'm glad our great high priest is not affected by that. Amen. I'm glad that no longer has to be done. Thank God. I'm glad he settled it, and he settled it all. He took care of that on the cross of Calvary. And that's the reason that you and I can look back to the cross and be reminded of what took place. Now, I know we didn't go to the site in Jerusalem where Calvary was and where Jesus Christ was actually crucified. But by faith, we trusted in the redemption plan of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. And we don't go back to that place, but we do it by faith and accepting the Lord Jesus Christ. And thank God it's through a sinless Savior that made that sacrifice. And therefore, we don't have to worry about whether our sins can be forgiven or not, because it's dependent upon his sinless life. So what a blessing that is. So we see that foundation is upon the shed blood of the sinless Savior. Look, if you would, please, in the book of Hebrews. I want to read a couple of verses to you there. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 4 and verse number 15. Give you a chance to turn there. Chapter 4, verse number 15. Some of you break it in your Bible, so I know it's hard for you to get there. Amen. So I mentioned we had those Bibles, and two ladies have already got them a new Bible already. So that's a blessing. Amen. A good King James Bible. They had a good King James Bible to start with, but they replaced it with a good King James Bible. But we see in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 15, the Bible says, "For we have not an high priest." Now remember, I was talking about the high priest, "which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are." Tempted like we are. But it didn't stop there. In the latter part of that verse, it says, "Yet without sin." He's a great high priest that never committed a sin. He never even thought of a sin. He never had a thought that would even be conceived as being a sin. We're talking about our sinless Savior. Then in the book of Hebrews, if you look please in chapter 7 and look at verses 26, down through verse number 28. Chapter 7, 26 through 28. The Bible tells us here, it says, "For such an high priest becometh us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins, and then for the people. For in that he died, in that he did once, when he was offered up to himself. For the law maketh men high priests, which have infirmities. But the word of oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son, who is consecrated forever." So we see here it tells us about the high priest, how that he hath to first of all make atonement for his own sins and make a sacrifice for his own sins. But the high priest that we have, the Bible tells us that he is harmless, that he's holy, that he's harmless, and that he's undefiled, and that he's separate from sinners. He's separate from sinners, but yet, when it means that, it means that he did not partake of the deeds of the sinful people. Thank God he came for sinners. One day he came to you. One day he came to me. He had to come to where we were. Why? Because we could not go to where he was. We could not do that. And Brother Buddy sings that song for us sometimes. He came to me. What a blessing the day he came to me. And what a blessing it was the day he came to you. And what a blessing it is to know that we have a Savior that is sinless and harmless and undefiled and separated in order that we might serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Look, if you would, please, in the book of 1 John. And notice in chapter number 3, in verse number 5, what it says. Chapter 3 and verse 5 of 1 John. I said you're going to be turning a little bit. The Bible says in verse number 5, it says, "And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin." Of course, I don't think we have a problem here tonight. I don't think we have anybody in this building tonight would think that the Lord Jesus Christ ever committed a sin. If he ever had committed one sin, he could not be our eternal sacrifice. We'd be in the same shape as the Old Testament was if he was not completely sinless and completely holy and completely undefiled. If he had committed one sin, he could not have died on the cross of Calvary and been the one final total sacrifice for all mankind to be saved. So we see and we enjoy the fact that the Lord Jesus Christ is forever our high priest. Now, if you would look at John chapter 18, in verse number 38, John 18, verse number 38. Notice what it says. "Concerning the sinless Savior that you and I serve and live for." 38, the Bible tells us, Pilate said unto him, "What is truth?" And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews and said unto them, what? He says, I find in him no fault at all. You know why he couldn't find a fault? Because there wasn't one. Amen. Now you can find fault in this preacher. Wouldn't take you very long to find a fault in me. Wouldn't take very long for us to find a fault in each other. We all have faults. We all have blemishes. That's the reason one day, thank God, the wrinkles and all the blemishes are all going to be done away with. All going to be ironed out. Going to be taken care of. But not one fault, not one person could find a fault in the Lord Jesus Christ. As he came before Pilate, and Pilate could find no fault with him, but still the people cried, "Crucify him, crucify him." And you'll see that in the Easter drama. On Friday night, the 28th, and on Easter Sunday morning, you'll see that as it's done in the Easter drama. How that he's brought before Pilate, how that the howling mob, how that the people came in crying, "Crucify, crucify, put him away, do away with him, do away with him, give us Barabbas." You'll see all that. But you see, he did that for you. He did that for me. And because there was no sin, that's the reason Pilate could not find any fault in him, because he was a perfect, perfect son of God. Thank God for that. And I praise his sweet name that he is. What a blessing to know him tonight. And what tell you a better blessing than that is that he knows us. So we see the glorious cross is its foundation. We see the shed blood of the sinless Savior. And then secondly of all tonight, I would like to note, want you to notice and pay attention that he is the substitute for the sinful sinner. Every one of us had to have a substitute. Now you probably know where I'm going. Over in the book of Isaiah chapter 53. What a tremendous passage of scripture. Oh, how many times have we read this? I mean, you can read this passage of Scripture, and if you meditate upon it and you really dwell upon it, and you really read it with your heart, it's hard not to shed a tear when you're reading this. When you realize what the precious, holy, perfect, sinless Son of God went through in order that we could be saved. Oh, we were guilty. Oh, yes, we deserved death. We deserved beating. We deserved the punishment. We deserved being crucified. But you see, he took our place. He was our substitute. And oh, thank God for that. I like that song that Chase sings in the Easter drama, "He Took My Place." I love that song. What a blessing. I relate to the fact that he stood in my place and took my place in your place in the sins of the whole entire world he took upon him. But in Isaiah chapter 53, notice what it says in verse number 1. We'll probably read down through about verse number 12. I know it's a little lengthy reading, but I want you to notice what it has to say concerning how that he was our substitute and he took our place. Verse number 1 said, "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when ye shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid as if it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet he did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. And he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, and we have turned every one from his own way. And the Lord hath laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and shall declare his generation, for he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in death, because he hath done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief, whom when thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. He shall see his seed, and he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities." Verse number 12. "Therefore will I divide him from a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sins of many, and made intercession for the transgressor." Just those 12 verses there, how many times is it referred to in a way that he took our place and that he was our substitute? It's very plain, the Bible is very plain on this fact, that it was our sins and our transgressions and our iniquities that Jesus Christ paid for when he died on the cross of Calvary. And even though he was sinless, and I thank God for that, and he was a sinless Savior, but thank God he died for the sinful sinner. And every one of us needed a Savior. When I look at this and I think about he took our place, I notice, first of all, in what we read to you, I see the punishment that he went through and that he endured. Oh my, what punishment. Oh, how he was beaten and how he was mocked and how he was spat upon, how he was his garments was ripped off of him. Oh, he went through all that punishment for you and for me. You see, he took our place. He took our place. And as Patty sang that song for us, I think it was just this past Sunday, when he was on the cross, we were on his mind. He was thinking about us. Thank God for that. I don't know. There's nobody else that can do that except the precious, sinless, darling Son of God. Not only do I think about the punishment, but if you look, if you please, over in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and look, if you would, please, in verse number 3. 1 Corinthians 15, verse number 3. I want you to notice not only the punishment, but I want you to think about the place. Chapter 15 and verse number 3. The Bible says, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures." The Word of God is plain. And of course, if you'll notice as you read that verse there, the letter, the Scriptures is in the letter capital S, which is referring to the Lord Jesus Christ being the Word of God, as it does over in John chapter 1 and verse number 14. So we see not only the punishment, we see the place. But then in 2 Corinthians, if you'll notice, please, in chapter 5, in verse number 27, notice what it says concerning our purge, our purging. And I use the word purge for the fact that we could use cleansing. But since we had punishment in place, I want you to see that purge, how that we've been cleansed and forgiven. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 21, notice what it says. Verse 21, it says, "For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Our sins were purged. Our sins were forgiven. The word purge simply means a cleansing. And I thank God the Bible tells us over in the book of 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 7 that the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. So we see that the sinless Savior shed his blood in order that the sinful sinner could be saved, because he became our substitute. Now, let me try to finish this one tonight. Not only the shed blood of a sinless Savior, not only the substitute for the sinful sinner, but I want you to notice the satisfaction of the sacred Scriptures. Well, we can stay here all night, but we won't. And I mentioned this just a moment ago, over in the book of John chapter 1. In fact, I was going to read verses 1 down through verse number 14, but for the sake of time tonight, I got something else I want to bring to you in order to get you out in time. I just want to read verse number 14, what it says in verse number 14. Where the Bible says in verse number 14, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Well, I'm glad this book is full of grace and is full of truth. I'll say, oh, thank God for that. If we are to be thankful for anything tonight, we ought to be thankful for the Word of God that has the grace of God in it and the truth of God in it and a whole lot more. But apart from the grace of God and the truth of God, then we would have nothing else to stand on. So we see here the satisfaction of the Scriptures. The Bible is plain. The Bible tells us in the book of John, I think it's chapter 1, verse number 29, if I'm not mistaken, I may be wrong on that. But the Bible says when they seen Jesus coming off, he said, "Behold, my son, this is my son in whom I am well pleased." And John says, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." And that's in the Scriptures. That's in the Word of God. He is the Scriptures. He is the Word. And we see that it's established all throughout the Word of God. We see that the titles and names of the Lord Jesus Christ, there's something like 117 different titles and names that are asserted to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the reason I'm mentioning that to you is because it refers to the Scriptures, and every one of these names and every one of these titles are in this Bible. It is in the Scriptures. Now, most of you are scared to death because you think I'm going to mention all 117 of them, but I am not. But I am going to mention some. I'm going to mention a few. I'm not going to turn and read the references. I'll give those to you. And if you want to do that later, that's up to you. But I will try to give you some of these. I have some of them marked. And I thought that, and all of them are good. None of them shouldn't be alleviated, but in order to save time. Number one, we see the title and name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the satisfaction of the Scripture. He's called the Almighty. The Almighty. I'm glad he's Almighty. Revelation chapter 1 and verse number 18. Revelation chapter 1 and verse number 8. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 13, he is called the Alpha and the Omega. You'll notice this will be going in alphabetical order. Then in 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 1, I know I might go too fast for you, but I can't slow up. We find there in 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 1, the Bible calls him our advocate. The word advocate just simply means that he's our counselor. He's our comforter. I don't know about you, but we need that. We need that in our lives as we serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Then I want you to notice not only that, but the Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 51 and verse number 9, the Lord Jesus Christ is referred to as the arm of the Lord. I'm glad today we got in our hymn book, I think it's page it is. In our hymn book, the song entitled, "Leaning on the Everlasting Arms." I'm glad that his arm is never weak. The Bible speaks of that outstretched arm. I'm glad for that also, but the Bible calls it the arm of the Lord. Then the Bible says and calls him the author and the finisher of our faith in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse number 2. The Bible calls him the blessed and the only potentate in 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse number 15. In Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse number 5, he is referred to as the branch. In John chapter 6, verse 35 and verse number 48, thank God he's referred to as the bread of life. Amen. Amen. I'm glad the Bible says when you eat of him, you'll never hunger again. If you drink of him, you'll never thirst again. The Bible tells us that he's the captain of the Lord's host in Joshua chapter 5 and verse number 14. The Bible tells us he's the captain of salvation in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 10. The Bible says he is the chief shepherd in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse... Hey, this is in the Bible, folks. This is the Word of God. The Bible says he is the chief cornerstone in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 20. The Bible tells us that he is the counselor in Isaiah chapter 9 and verse number 6. The Bible says he tells us that he is the day spring in Luke chapter 1 and verse number 78. The Bible says he's our deliverer in Romans chapter 11 and verse number 26. He says he's the door in John chapter 11, chapter 10 and verse number 7. The Bible says he is Emmanuel in Matthew chapter 1 and verse number 23, which being interpreted, God is with us. That's why we have our church name, Emmanuel Baptist Church. God is with us. And let me just say, folks, he's been with us every step of the way. He's never been lax. He's never been. Hey, thank God he's always been there. And I'm glad he always will be. Thank God for the names and the titles that has such a value in them as we read them. The Bible says that he's eternal life in 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 2. The Bible says he's the everlasting Father in Isaiah 9 and verse number 6. He says he's the first and the last in Revelation chapter 1 and verse number 17. He's the first begotten of the dead in Revelation chapter 1 and verse number 5. He's the firstborn of every creature in Colossians chapter 1 and verse number 15. Just simply put, he's God in Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 9. He's the glory of the Lord in Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 5. He's the good shepherd in John chapter 10 and verse number 14. He's the great high priest in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 14. He's the head of the church in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse number 23. He's the heir of all things in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse number 2. Some of you give up on me, didn't you? He's the Holy One in Psalms chapter 16 and verse number 10. He's the horn of salvation in Luke chapter 1 and verse number 16. Thank God he's the great I Am in Exodus chapter 3 and verse number 14. He's Jehovah in Isaiah 26 and verse number 4. He's called Jesus in Matthew chapter 1 and verse number 21. He's the just one in Acts chapter 7 and verse number 52. He's the king in Matthew chapter 21 and verse number 5. Hallelujah. Praise the holy name. He's the king of kings in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 15. He's the lamb in Revelation chapter 5 and verse number 6. He's the leader in Isaiah 55 and 4. He's life in John chapter 14 and verse number 6. He's the light of the world in John 8 chapter 12. He's the Lord of glory in 1 Corinthians 2:18. He's Lord of all in Acts chapter 10 verse number 36. He's Lord our righteousness in Isaiah 23:6. He's Lord Almighty in Revelation chapter 15 and verse number 3. He's mediator in 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse number 5. He's Messiah in Daniel chapter 9 and verse number 25. He's mighty God in Isaiah 9:6. He's the morning star in Revelation 22:16. He's the only begotten in John 1:14. He's the Prince of Life in Acts chapter 3, verse number 15. He's the Prince of Peace in Isaiah 9:6. He's the ransom in 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse number 6. He's Redeemer in Isaiah chapter 59 and verse number 20. He's the resurrection and life in John chapter 11 and verse number 25. He's the rock in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse number 4. He's the Savior in 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse number 20. He's servant in Isaiah chapter 42 and verse number 1. He's the shepherd and the bishop of our soul in 1 Peter Peter chapter 2 and verse number 25. He's the Son of God in Luke chapter 1 and verse number 35. He's the Son of Man in John chapter 5 and verse number 27. He's the star in Numbers 24 and verse number 17. He's the Son of Righteousness in Malachi chapter 4 and verse number 2. He's surety in Hebrews chapter 7 and verse number 22. He's the true God in 1 John chapter 20, chapter 5 and verse number 20. He's the true light in John chapter 1 and verse number 9. He's the true vine in John chapter 15 and verse number 1. He's the truth in John chapter 14 and verse number 6. He's the way in John 14:6. He's wonderful in Isaiah 9:6. He's the word in John 1:1. He's the word of God in Revelation 19:13. And thank God he's the word of life in 1 John 1:1. Hope y'all got all them. Randy says he's got it right here. Aren't you glad that the scripture gives us satisfaction? See, we're not built upon no sinking sand. Thank God, hallelujah. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. Amen. Hope it helped you tonight. We're the church folk. Don't ever think we're going down. Hallelujah. One of these days we're going up. And it might be tonight. It could be before we leave here. Let's stand if you would, please. I hope that helped you tonight. I really do. I hope it blessed you. Oh, what a blessing it is just to see what the Word of God has to offer. What the Word of God says. Heads bowed and eyes closed. If you need to come, Sister Patty's going to play something for us. If you need to come tonight, just slip out and make your way down to the altar. Thank God for the church. I'm glad I'm a part of the family of God. It's more than just a title. You know, people get all upset and all bothered about their church membership, about their church letters if they change churches to go somewhere else. That's nothing more than just a piece of paper of recommendation. Boy, I'm glad my name's written in the indelible blood of the Lord Jesus Christ in the Lamb's Book of Life. And I'm glad I'm a member of the true church, one that's believed and trusted in the Lord Jesus. Some around the altar praying. If you need to come, others are coming, just slip out and come. It's God to help you. He'll do it. He'll do it. Yes, sir, he will. Give you an opportunity to do business with him. Several people around the altar. What a blessing that is to see. That's encouraging. Pray for these at the altar. Pray God will just help them, bless them in a special way. Amen. Thank God for those that have come. from this coming Friday will be the first service for the Easter drama. So be much in prayer about it. Pray God would use it for his glory. Let's bow our heads and be dismissed in a word of prayer. We'll ask the Lord's blessing to be upon us as we're dismissed. Lord, watch over us.